This is A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. On today's show, the Low Carbon Fuel Standards Program. What is it all about? Is it contributing to mitigating the climate crisis? I'll speak to staff attorney at the Leadership Council for Justice and Accountability, Jamie Katz, and deputy director of the UC Davis Policy Institute for Energy, Environment, and the Economy, and co-director of the UC Davis Institute of Transportation Studies Low Carbon Fuel Policy Research Initiative, Colin Murphy. But first, the news.
I'm Christina Onnestead with KPFA News Headlines. Former President Donald Trump is now the first U.S. president in history to be charged in a federal indictment. He was charged with mishandling classified documents at his Mar-a-Lago, Florida estate. He faces 7 counts, including willful retention of national defense information, obstruction of justice, false statements, and conspiracy. The indictment carries the possibility of prison if he's convicted and has political implications, potentially upending his Republican presidential campaign. Something Trump pointed to when he made the indictment public on social media late Thursday and released a video blasting the charges against him.
Our country is going to hell, and they come after Donald Trump, weaponizing the Justice Department, weaponizing the FBI. We can't let this continue to go on because it's ripping our country to shreds. It's called election interference. They're trying to destroy a reputation so they can win an election. So I just want to tell you, I'm an innocent man. I did nothing wrong.
Trump will reportedly appear in a Miami court Tuesday. Ukraine says it has evidence Russia blew up the Kakhovka Dam, an intercepted phone call of a Russian sabotage group discussing the dam's damage and using derogatory terms against Ukrainians. Russia blames Ukraine for the dam's breach. The UK's Guardian is reporting data from Norway points to an explosion at the dam just before its breach earlier this week. Norwegian scientists say signals from a regional station in Romania suggest an explosion occurred before the dam was destroyed. At least 14 people have died. Many are homeless, and tens of thousands are without drinking water. FSN's Julia Chapman has more.
At least one civilian was killed in shelling in the city of Kherson on Thursday, with Kyiv accusing Moscow of attacking those evacuating the flooding. Journalist Tom Much has visited the Kherson region.
The Ukrainian government is warning that the worst of the flooding is still to come, that there could be a higher water level coming in the next 2 or 3 days. Again, this is actually going to affect Russian-occupied areas even worse because they're on the lower bank of the river. So I think, while it does look like the Ukrainians have managed to rescue a large number of people, as far as the flooding is going, the worst is yet to come.
I'm Julia Chapman.
Meanwhile, Russia says it's thwarted Ukraine's anticipated spring offensive, destroying armored vehicles and dozens of tanks in the Zaporizhia region. The White House says it has intelligence indicating Iran is providing Russia with materials to build a drone manufacturing plant east of Moscow, just as the Kremlin looks to lock in a steady supply of weaponry for its ongoing war in Ukraine. White House National Security Council spokesman John Kirby today said U.S. intelligence officials believe a plant in Russia's Alabuga Special Economic Zone could be operational by early next year. Here in California, Governor Gavin Newsom proposed a 28th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution yesterday. It would enshrine gun control provisions. Max Pringle has more.
Newsom announced his plan in a video. It featured images from the recent spate of mass shootings around the nation.
They tell us we can't stop these massacres. They tell us we have to stand by and watch tragedy after tragedy unfold in our communities.
Newsom's proposed amendment would raise the minimum age to buy a gun from 18 to 21. It would require a reasonable waiting period after a gun purchase, a federal background check on all gun purchases, and it would ban the sale and possession of military-style assault weapons.
Given the nature of the amendment process and the power of the NRA, it is a challenge.
John Donahue is a constitutional law professor at Stanford University.
Pretty much every other affluent country in the world would look at what Governor Newsom said and said, oh my God, this is so modest what he is proposing. And yet the gun lobby and the aggressive Republicans who carry that banner try to paint it as, you know, some enormous infringement on rights.
To get to a constitutional amendment, two-thirds of states agree to call a convention. Then, either three-fourths of state legislatures or two-thirds of state conventions would have to agree. I'm Max Pringle.
Another day of unhealthy smoke in the Northeast due to some 400 wildfires scorching across Canada. It spread to the Carolinas. Smoke has spread to the Carolinas, Indiana, and as far as the Nordic nation of Norway. President Joe Biden canceled a White House Pride Day event Thursday due to unhealthy air quality. Speaking during a press briefing with the UK's Prime Minister Rishi Sunak, Biden urged people to adhere to air quality advisories.
Firefighters on the ground have been there for a while in Canada, including hotshots and the smoke jumper crews. And it's very important that affected communities listen to the guidance of their state and local officials.
Meanwhile, climate justice advocates braved the hazardous air and staged a rally outside the White House Thursday, linking the smoke and wildfires to climate change and demanding action.
Climate justice, now!
Dr. Crystal Cavalier-Keck with the NAACP and the Aqua Aniche Band of Saponi Nation in North Carolina.
Humanity has reached a breaking point. Look around. It is fitting that we are now, that the earth is on fire. We are here. We will have to live with fire from now on. Because of Western colonization and taking away how people steward it, and I mean everybody, how we care for the lands now, we have lost control.
Demands included a rejection of the Mountain Valley Pipeline, which was approved in the default deal the president brokered with Democrats. Also, a declaration for a climate emergency, ending new fossil fuel projects, phasing out oil and gas drilling on public lands, and making renewable energy more available for homes and transportation. The weather forecast for the San Francisco Bay Area today: mostly cloudy, highs in the mid-60s to lower 70s, winds up to 20 miles per hour. The weather trend will continue into the weekend. In Fresno and the central San Joaquin Valley, sunny, highs near 87 degrees. The weather trend will continue into the weekend as well. I'm Christina Onnestad reporting for KPFA.
Welcome back. We are back. I'm going to start with the definition of low carbon fuel standards, or LCFS. And this is coming from the U.S. Department of Energy, as defined by the U.S. Department of Energy. California's low carbon fuel standard program, LCFS, requires a reduction in the carbon intensity of transportation fuels that are sold, supplied, or offered for sale in the state through 2030. The California Air Resources Board regulations require transportation fuel producers and importers to meet specific average carbon intensity requirements for fuel. LCFS regulated fuels include natural gas, electricity, hydrogen, gasoline mixed with at least 10% corn-derived ethanol, biomass-based diesel, and propane. Non-biomass-based alternative fuels that are supplied in California for use in transportation at an aggregate volume of less than 3.6 million gasoline gallon equivalents per year are exempt from LCFS requirements. Other exemptions apply for transportation fuel used in specific applications. The LCFS program allows producers and importers to generate, acquire, transfer, bank, borrow, and trade credits. Fuel producers and importers regulated under the LCFS must meet quarterly and annual reporting requirements. So It's a program that's been around for a bit, but it's very possible this program may be actually slowing progress by overwhelmingly supporting the production of combustion fuels about electrification because it's outdated, to name one of the concerns from many advocates. Well, here to talk about all of this, LCFS and whatnot, the program, is Colin Murphy. And Colin Murphy is the Deputy Director of the UC Davis Policy Institute for Energy, Environment, and the Economy, and Co-Director of the UC Davis Institute of Transportation Studies Low Carbon Fuel Policy Research Initiative. We also have Jamie Katz, and Jamie Katz is a staff attorney with Leadership Council for Justice and Accountability, and their work focuses on co-creating with residents an energy transition that benefits disadvantaged communities in inland California and does not continue patterns of disinvestment, pollution, and environmental racism. Folks, welcome to A Rude Awakening. Truly appreciate you taking the time with this extremely dense subject matter. Thank you so much.
Very happy to be here.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
Yes, absolutely. So, talk to us about this program. I'm going to go ahead and start with you, Colin, and Jamie, whenever you feel necessary, go ahead and jump in. Okay. Let's talk about the implications of this policy for the average person, someone who's, you know, living in one of these at-risk communities around one of these farms or dairy farms and what have you. Colin, I'll go ahead and start with you. Jamie, go ahead and chime in when you feel the need. Go ahead.
Sure. So at a statewide level, the LCFS is meant to ensure that the state is on track to meet its goals for achieving carbon neutrality by 2045. And while we know that electric vehicles are by far the single most important tool we have to reduce emissions, particularly out of passenger cars and trucks, even if you make the most optimistic and ambitious possible assumptions about how quickly they can deploy and how they're going to be used, there's still a couple billion gallons a year of fuel demand from the old sort of legacy vehicles. And this is even if we hit our target of selling no more gasoline cars by 2035. Plus, there are some areas of the transportation system that are just not a great fit for batteries, things like aircraft and a few other specialized applications. So you need to have a policy that can find ways to provide fuel for all these things that's lower carbon than petroleum, because we know that if we're using a significant amount of petroleum in 2045, we have no shot at achieving carbon neutrality. And so we know from sort of historical experience working with biofuels, which at least right now are the only scalable option, though hopefully we'll get some alternatives in the next decade or two. We know that biofuels, if you don't look at the full life cycle impact of the fuels, everything from producing the biomass to converting it to a fuel to bringing it to market, you can end up with some biofuels that are worse than the petroleum that they're trying to displace. And so the LCFS is a policy that tries to balance this, to use life cycle analysis to understand the carbon impacts of everything and put together a portfolio of fuels that can find reductions where we can today, and also provide much deeper and better support for the stuff that can really get us closer to zero in the long run, things like electricity. Particularly comes from low carbon sources and some of the advanced liquid fuels that are just trying to scale up to commercial scale right now. For the average person, it's not terribly apparent. It does apply a charge to conventional gasoline and diesel. Basically, the LCFS works by having the high carbon fuels pay to bring the low carbon fuels onto the market. And since gasoline and diesel are very high carbon and the majority fuel right now, the LCFS applies a charge. At current prices, it's less than 10 cents a gallon, but part of that's because the credit price in the LCFS market is low, and that's a very complex subject we can get into later if we want. But it applies a charge to gasoline and diesel, and so everybody's going to sort of feel that at the pump, and that money goes to support things like electricity, biofuels, renewable diesel, and renewable natural gas. If you're living next to one of the producers, the renewable natural gas producers that are really the subject of a lot of controversy right now, The LCFS is one of the things that helps pay for those producers to switch from open lagoon management. And so these are things like dairies and livestock yards. And historically, they would often just sort of flush all of the manure and effluent into a big pond and let it decompose there. And that obviously had a lot of environmental impacts.
So that's that smell.
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I apologize. Let me just interrupt you really quick. So when you're driving through, like you're going down the Grapevine, you're going down the 5, or you're going down the 880, or any of these freeways that are going through these farms, that's what you're smelling. Is that kind of rotten, eggy smell?
That's most of it. The other thing is another smell is silage, which is basically fermented, chopped up corn stalks, which is one of the things they feed cows. Mm. But if it smells really bad, it's probably the manure you're smelling.
Gotcha. Okay. Go ahead.
So one of the ways that you can, you know, help reduce the impact of those animal operations and also make, you know, some energy is instead of just having all that stuff decompose and vent methane and a whole bunch of pollutants into the air, you can put a cover over it. And when it's covered and when there's no oxygen given to bacteria that are decomposing organic matter, they tend to produce a lot of methane. And so the idea behind digesters is you put a cap over it, you capture the methane, you have to sort of purify it, take out some of the toxic and smelly stuff like hydrogen sulfide, take out the water vapor because that can interfere with the equipment you're using. And then once you've purified it, it's something that chemically is pretty similar to natural gas. Most of the evidence says that if you have a choice between living next to, you know, a CAFO with an open lagoon or a CAFO with a digester, the digester reduces, does not eliminate, very clearly does not eliminate, but reduces the sort of air and in many cases water pollution. There are potentially some better options out there. That doesn't necessarily haven't been demonstrated to the same level that digesters have. Europe uses a lot of digesters, so it's a technology that's at least well understood from the European experience. And there are some, you know, criticisms that we should be looking at other approaches other than digesters in order to address this problem. Which, you know, there's certainly fair criticism. There's also a lot of criticism that we just shouldn't have nearly as many concentrated, you know, CAFOs and really densely packed dairies. And that is also a completely fair criticism. But yeah, that's sort of the high level view of it.
Yeah, from 50,000 feet. My goodness. So Jamie Katz, staff attorney with Leadership Council for Justice and Accountability. Now, you're all about being on those front lines and working to focus on co-creating with residents an energy transition that benefits disadvantaged communities in inland California. And that is no easy feat because it's you're down in the trenches, you're going to Sacramento. It's like, do you ever get a break, right? So with that, talk to us about this SB 709 or any other policies or potential laws that may be coming to fruition that your organization is working on to move it from a credit type situation to just elimination. Talk to us about what you're working on right now. Go ahead.
Sure. No, really appreciate that. I think Colin gave a good background of some of the policy background.
Indeed.
Just want to supplement that. Just to respond to your direct question, SB 709 is a bill authored by Senator Ben Allen that looks to address some of the unintended consequences of the LCFS, and I'd be happy to circle back to that, but I think it would be helpful just to give a little bit of context about why we're talking about, you know, we're talking about the low carbon fuel standard, we're talking about a policy designed to reduce the average greenhouse gas emissions from transportation fuel in California as part of California's trying to achieve its climate goals. So why are we talking about dairies, right? So dairies in California are some of the biggest dairies in the country. I think people maybe have an impression who don't live near these facilities that, you know, of kind of what a dairy is. But the reality is that, you know, my understanding is, you know, the average dairy size is something like 1,500 cows. And in the San Joaquin Valley, it's pretty common to see dairies of 3,000, 5,000, 8,000, sometimes more than 10,000 animals. And it's quite different sort of how a facility of that size operates as opposed to sort of the bucolic image that one might have of a dairy. And that's part of what contributes to, you know, for folks who don't live in the region, when you're driving through, when you smell those odors. I also think it's important for us to recognize that these, you know, livestock methane emissions are a significant source of greenhouse gas emissions in the state. You know, livestock emissions account for, I believe, 55% of methane emissions in the state. So, you know, they're a major source. And, you know, a few years ago, a bill in 2016 called SB 1383 passed, which included a number of provisions. But one of the things that it said is that rather than treat methane emissions from these very large dairies like we would other major sources of greenhouse gas emissions, we're going to incentivize them to reduce those emissions and place significant barriers to implementing regulation in the future. It actually removed the Air Resources Board's ability to directly regulate livestock methane emissions until January 1st, 2024, which fortunately, you know, is a near-term opportunity that we would love to see CARB approach beginning in 2024. That said, that bill passing in 2016 set us on this path where California's policy is to Colin's point, to treat sort of the most polluting, most climate intensive herd and manure management practices as the default, and then to reward operators of these dairies for any captured methane, any sort of improvement from the most climate and pollution intensive practices, that being liquefied manure. So rather than putting the manure in a pile, rather than, you know, whatever, you're flushing that manure out with water, you're putting it in an acres large manure cesspool, acres and acres large, which again pollutes local air, contributing to higher rates of asthma, higher rates of cancer in the community, pollutes local groundwater. And when you store manure in water, it produces more methane. And in order to have a digester, you need to store the manure in water. And so it's this really sort of backwards notion that we have, that we are strongly incentivizing. And I mean, very strongly. You know, you look at, without kind of getting too in the weeds, the sort of valuation that the low carbon fuel standard is giving for fuels derived from livestock manure, it is an order of magnitude greater than what we're giving for other fuels, where the LCFS basically treats as zero electric vehicles, but has this huge amount of credits that they give for factory farms. So it's sort of to circle back, you know, there's a couple of things that, you know, Leadership Council, the residents that we work alongside in the San Joaquin Valley, and then our partners in the environmental movement and the environmental justice movement are calling for. So I think SB 709, you know, we can delve into the details of that policy, but uplift some really key reforms that CARB really needs to incorporate into the low carbon fuel standard. But then fundamentally, you know, the Air Resources Board is in the midst of a rulemaking process to update the low carbon fuel standard. And, you know, what we, along with many other organizations, are calling for is the elimination of sort of an accounting mechanism called avoided methane crediting, which in our eyes is sort of the primary driver of this impression that Installing these digesters is a huge benefit to the climate. Also calling for additional oversight in the form of an additional board meeting for the Air Resources Board. And then I think that the final thing that I'll say for now is just to, you know, we don't need to get into a big back and forth about this. Colin, I've heard what you've raised. I'd be interested to see the study that you're referring to, which talks about, which my understanding from how you describe it was that the installation of a digester improves local air and water. We've seen some studies in the past that make those claims. We've also seen studies that make the opposite claim. And frankly, what we hear from residents who live near digesters is that often the odors are worse and they're not seeing improvements in their public health, in their water quality. So, you know, what we're hearing from firsthand experience is that, you know, fundamentally the issue is about too many cows sort of concentrated in low-income communities of color who've been living with this impact for too long. And digesters are being sort of touted as the solution to that. And we're not really seeing that on the ground.
Okay. Well, let me just go ahead and read out SB 709. SB 709, a bill that aims to adjust the program to accurately reflect the emissions of biogas production and the amount of credits that can therefore be generated. The bill would prevent dairy operations from expanding for the sole purpose of generating waste to profit from the LCFS program. So, Colin, what say you? This it seems like, you know, these dairy farms could just be doing that for their own benefit. But at the same time, the communities, the frontline communities that live nearby these large scale factory farms, you know, there's a huge risk of certain cancers, kidney disease, anemia, blood bacterial infection, and so on and so forth. What say you, Colin? Go ahead.
Sure. So first of all, and I think Jamie and I agree on more than we disagree on. And so absolutely agree that even with a digester in place, there are local environmental concerns and that our current regulatory structure is probably not addressing those in as effective or focused a manner as needed. And absolutely agree that when you look at the studies on digesters to date, they've been difficult to implement and to keep operational. So you have, you know, if a digester is working properly and sort of being fully maintained, and, you know, designed appropriately for the situation, they can be effective, but that, you know, the ifs in that sentence are carrying a lot of weight, and they're not always maintained properly, and they're not always doing what they're supposed to do. And so absolutely agree that additional oversight in their use is almost certainly a good idea. I think, you know, one of the questions is, if you're going to have a state with a lot of dairies and a state where there's, you know, a lot of production of milk, there's a lot of people involved in working that, you know, what is the best way to manage it? I don't know that there is a solution out there that turns a concentrated animal feeding operation like a dairy or a livestock yard into something that, you know, is completely environmentally benign. And so, you know, again, the idea behind something like a digester is to reduce the impacts. And if that is not a sufficient reduction, then I completely support the ability of communities to say, no, we don't want this in our community. You know, one of the only things that I think, you know, where Jamie and I disagree is the idea of an avoided methane credit does have a lot of use in a climate policy. Now, I'm certainly not going to say that the way it's being applied in the case of digesters is appropriate. And you can find comment letters with my name on them going back to 2016 or so. Said telling the Air Resources Board that I think the way it's being applied in the cases of digesters is far too generous. But as a basic concept, the idea of giving somebody credit for reducing fugitive emissions of methane, given the number of places in our economy that methane is released from, and given its really strong impact on climate forcing, finding ways to reduce that ends up being very important if we're going to meet a lot of the critical climate targets. So, I am certainly not arguing that the system as it is today, stay in perpetuity. There's a lot of things that Jamie said that I completely agree with and absolutely agree that more regulation and oversight on these is needed. I also think that, like he said at the start of his comments, we should just be regulating methane emissions and not trying to solve the problem in an incentive only approach.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, Jamie Katz, it's going to take some time. It's going to take some time. That's what a lot of these dairy farmers in particular would be arguing. I would even venture to say BachMed would argue. And it's not going to happen overnight. But yet, these policies are outdated. What is your solution, or what are your thoughts on a solution as far as your organization, Leadership Council for Justice and Accountability, are concerned? How can this be alleviated immediately, if at all?
Yeah, no, I think that's a great question. I think I agree with you that these issues can be complicated, and it's very can be easy when thinking about how to solve all of these complex challenges as, solving some of the thornier challenges related to climate change often are. It can be challenging. I certainly hear what you're saying when it seems like this is going to take a long time. I will tell you that what I hear from residents that live near these facilities is that they've been told to wait for a long time. And I think it's long past overdue that California can continue to accept that, the impact on the quality of people's lives and their health is acceptable as sort of a byproduct for us trying to achieve other policy goals, in this case, climate. And I'm certainly not attributing that to Colin at all. I'm attributing that to other folks. I think I agree, Colin, that we likely agree on much more than we disagree. What we're looking for frankly, we don't think that the California should be incentivizing the production of this gas, because in order to produce it, you need to purposely be creating methane. You need to be concentrating animals in such a way that it impacts the health and the well-being of your neighbors. Part of the challenge of addressing climate change is that we need to transform and reimagine the way that we meet our needs. And I think the notion that we have created sort of a market and deregulated environment such that large dairies get to not only continue to operate in the sort of profit maximizing, externalizing impacts on public health, they get to keep doing that, but they also get to claim, as they did repeatedly in these workshops last week, that they're climate champions. Just think about, a Chevron of the world coming in and claiming that they're a climate champion. And they do that, but then they're rightfully called out for saying you can't both be a major contributor to climate change and also be considered a champion. I think we would welcome the idea of a dairy industry that operates in such a way that they are stewards of the climate and good neighbors. But it seems clear that digesters are not the path to do that. And so we would look to see, again, sort of changes to the low carbon fuel standards such that sort of the true net climate impact of these facilities is taken into account, and that the low carbon fuel standard sort of truly prioritizes what California's policy priorities are in every other space, which is electrification. I think that's what I would say.
Most definitely. Yeah, that was, yeah, I think it was the second day. Actually, Colin, when you chimed in with your comments regarding the situation, it was a lot of dairy farmers. We've got digesters. We're doing the best we can. And it was just basically the same message being pounded into folks. But at the same time, there were a few folks that were like, hey, look, I have to live near this. You know, my family, my whole family has asthma. My whole family has dealt with this, that, and the third. And it's like, okay, why would this be incentivized? And I mean, I get it in the first place to get these dairy farms on board to try to work towards mitigating the climate crisis, but to keep doing it, it's like, wait a minute, it seems pretty backwards. Colin, you know, not everybody can afford an electric car, right? So, you know, electrification, that, yeah, that sounds great, you know, being able to, you know, switch a lot of the stuff over to solar or what have you. But you know, heck, folks can't even afford a used car, a used combustible car, let alone an electric car. So it's just, you know, we're not in that space right now. What do you say to pushing towards electrification? Shouldn't those incentives be put towards incentivizing folks to get themselves electrified as opposed to giving out credits for creating methane? That just sounds backwards. Go ahead.
So the LCFS gives a lot of incentive for electrification already. And by, you know, most of the modeling says 2026 or seven, maybe 2028, it'll be receiving the most of any type of fuel out of the LCFS. It has already been hugely beneficial for transit agencies that are adopting electric buses because of the sort of the way the LCFS takes into account the efficiency of electric motors and the fact that the stop and go driving buses do are really a good match for batteries. For a while, some agencies were getting enough out of LCFS credits to basically pay for the electricity the buses were doing. That's, you know, I'm not saying it's going to always be the case, but we are seeing a lot of revenue go from the LCFS into electricity. I think right now it's the third largest recipient of credits in the program. And like I said, it'll be number one within a few years. But like I said at the top, there's just no way for electrification to do it all. Even if we hit our target of selling no more internal combustion engine vehicles by 2035, conventional cars last 15 or 20 years. And so there's going to be a big fleet of those remaining on the road that are going to need fuel, as well as some applications, again, you know, air travel being the biggest and most obvious of them, that batteries are just not a great fit for. We don't really see a pathway batteries being able to solve every problem. They can solve most of the problems, but not all of them. And so you have to have something that brings in solutions, because brings in lower carbon solutions than petroleum, because, you know, if you have to satisfy all those residual needs for the remaining light duty vehicles and aircraft and a few other specialty applications, if all it has to be petroleum, we've got no chance at carbon neutrality by 2045, or really, you know, early enough to make a difference in halting the worst impacts of climate change. And so when you have something like a big methane emitter like concentrated animal operations like dairies and livestock yards, you know, for one thing, I do agree it has been a historical failure of governance and environmental policy that let them adopt open lagoons as the default way of dealing with manure. And, you know, we shouldn't have spent the last 30 plus years allowing that to happen. But that's what is in place at almost all the dairies out there. And so finding some way to reduce those emissions and reduce them as soon as possible, again, given the outsized impact of methane, is really important. The other thing is, while we know that we are going to be reducing the amount of natural gas we consume, you know, radically over the next couple of decades, that means switching things like stoves and home heating away from natural gas and reducing the amount of natural gas we use to generate electricity. There are some uses of natural gas that you can't really electrify. There are things when you're making plastics or chemicals or a few other applications where there isn't really a pathway to switch to renewable electricity, which is something that we know we can make in very large scale cost effectively. Something where, you know, these are applications where you need the actual methane molecule, not necessarily energy that it carries. And for those things, you're going to need to find some source of methane. And again, if that methane is coming from fossil fuels, it becomes really hard for us to meet our carbon neutrality targets. But if you use digesters, and there are many kinds of digesters, livestock digesters are sort of one aspect of it, but you can also get, you know, renewable natural gas out of landfills. You can get it from digestion of organic waste, you know, things like food that would have otherwise been thrown out, or agricultural residue. So the digestion of all this sort of organic waste that society generates and is going to keep generating for the foreseeable future is a way that you can potentially make enough methane to fill those needs that can't really be electrified. Now, I agree, you know, those needs aren't in transportation, and how we got the subsidy to bring RNG into transportation is a long story that gets into, you know, sort of the history of climate policy and people back in 2007 and 2008 when they were really designing the LCFS having to work knowing, you know, a tiny fraction of what we know now about advanced technology and the pace of climate policy. If we were designing things from a clean sheet of paper, we wouldn't be trying to move methane into the transportation sector. But there is going to be a need for some methane, probably forever. You know, again, for some specialized applications. And so it's got to come from somewhere. And it's going to be better to have that come from, you know, various kinds of organic waste digestion than it is to keep drilling holes in the ground and pulling fossil fuels out.
Wow. This is a huge undertaking. Huge undertaking. Thank you for that, Colin Murphy out of UC Davis. So Jamie Katz, I got one more question for you, and then of course have the closeout question for both of you. On the policy tip, legal tip. Are you seeing any opportunity to start trying to push through policies that are going to benefit the folks that are on the front line? Because it seems to me that there is this resistance, because all of these, in this particular situation, dairy farmers or dairy farms, you know, they've purchased these digesters, they've invested into these digesters, and they just want to stick with this particular method, this particular MO, modus operandi, right? So, but at the same time, it's not really helping anybody except for them. That's what it seems to me, right? That is what I'm deducing from this conversation and from the public gathering that BACMED put together last week. So, Jamie Katz, talk to me about what would be necessary to push through the policies that are going to help the people that are on the front lines. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's... Big question. You know, I will say just a point of clarification that, you know, a lot of the funding for these digesters and for the existing pipelines were actually paid for by the public. You know, California's put in something like $700 million public dollars. We're talking tax dollars and ratepayer dollars. And so I think that's worth noting that we're, you know, we as a state, we as the, you know, residents of California have put a lot of money into these very large dairies. And again, when you've got a dairy with thousands of animals, I wouldn't describe you as low income. So we're subsidizing that. So I think that's one point of clarification. In terms of what, you know, appropriate policies are, I mean, I think, you know, important things, again, SB 709 would make some really important changes. Not only to the low carbon fuel standard, focusing on the low carbon fuel standard, but not only to sort of the climate accounting, but would really restrict this sort of perverse incentive we're seeing to sort of concentrate more animals in communities that are already impacted by dairies. It would also increase transparency. And I think that's one big piece of this that we haven't touched on thus far, is that, you know, residents have a really hard time tracking the expansion of these facilities and the installation of digesters and pipelines in their communities, partly because the Air Resources Board redacts a lot of that information as sort of confidential business information when we're talking about, again, numbers of animals, when I think we can all agree that, you know, it makes a meaningful impact if you currently live next to a facility with 1,500 cows and suddenly there are going to be 4,000 cows. That's going to make a tangible difference in terms of your quality of life and sort of the impacts on the health, the public health of your community. And, you know, as a local elected official, a couple of them in a community where we work shared recently, you know, they smell, you know, what we've been talking about, the smell of manure, and the smell of silage, which for folks who don't live in the valley, you know, they roll up their windows as they drive by. You know, as these local elected officials say, to them, that's the smell of money because they grew up owning dairies. Well, if you don't have access to that, the profits from those facilities, it doesn't smell like money. You know, it's the money. It's the smell of harm. It's the smell of, yes, you know, asthma. And so I think that, again, greater transparency, because at a minimum, then that gives residents the opportunity to raise their concerns, and, you know, gives the State Air Resources Board, who's, you know, tasked with protecting, you know, the quality of air in California, the sort of opportunity to really step in and make needed changes to ensure that dairies are not operating in a way that impacts public health. So SB 709 is a huge part of it. We also, again, would call, you know, as I've raised earlier, the phasing out of avoided methane crediting, which CARB itself already calls for. They just say not until 2040. And that, you know, as came up in the workshop, Professor Michael Wara from Stanford laid out a really compelling case that we could phase out avoided methane crediting in 2024 and still meet our climate goals. So the LCFS could still accomplish its goals. And then just call, again, sort of in the vein of greater transparency, calling for, you know, two board meetings. Right now, the CARB board is just going to hear this matter of the LCFS one time this year, which doesn't really give a meaningful opportunity to provide feedback and really make sure that we get this really important policy right.
Mm-hmm. Can I add something to that?
Absolutely, Colin. Go ahead.
So I absolutely agree that there's a need for more transparency. CARB tends to take a fairly expansive view of what is proprietary business information. And so when they publish pathways, a lot is redacted, and it makes it very difficult for researchers like myself and my colleagues to you know, understand these systems at a detailed level. And really also it makes it hard for us to be able to look at pathway applications, which, you know, are supposed to be public enough that the public can see them and serve sort of an additional oversight function. You know, we look at them and we can't really tell if they make sense or not, because too much is redacted for us to see if the numbers are really lining up. The other thing is, you know, Jamie mentioned that a lot of these projects are getting support from other sources as well. And this is absolutely true. And so, you know, this gets into the technical term is additionality, and it's a, you know, a complex rabbit hole that you know, I personally love to go down. I'm not sure if all your listeners would totally agree. But what it basically means is, if we're trying to assess what the value of a given project is, we have to compare it to what would have happened otherwise, right? If the project just didn't occur. And so the way CARB has dealt with additionality is just look at, you know, is something legal or illegal, right? If it was illegal, if there was a regulation saying they had to control methane, then these avoided methane credits would be non-additional, but otherwise they are additional, which is binary, either it is or it isn't. And I think that where we are, and I mean, this is California as well as the US and the rest of the world, we are in a position where we have to go and transition our economy and our way of life into a much more sustainable footing and a much more lower carbon footing. And that's going to require a lot of different types of policies and different types of incentives. And so it's not going to be black and white anymore about whether this program or that program caused somebody to make a change. And so I think that, you know, CARB really should be thinking about additionality in a new and a kind of more nuanced way, where it's not that something is 100% additional or not additional at all, but if there's additional money coming in from other programs or other sources of support, then, you know, the LCFS credit helps, and maybe they get part of the avoided methane credit, but not all of it. And right now, even with the other sources of support, they get all of it. So there are absolutely a lot of ways to update the system and make it a better reflection of how things are actually happening.
Yeah, Colin, we don't have to have a long conversation about, I would welcome a longer conversation about additionality. I think just a point of clarification is, you know, my understanding, CARB at this time does not require additionality for fuel pathways under the low carbon fuel standard, effectively saying that even if a fuel producer was already obligated to make certain, in this case, methane emission reductions as a result of receiving funding through another program, even if they were already committed to that, even if they were already accounted for in another program, the low carbon fuel standard could also claim those reductions. That's what we're seeing on the ground, where projects are receiving funding from the Dairy Digester Research and Development Fund, the Aliso Canyon Mitigation Settlement. We're seeing this on the ground, and you know, meeting 1383 targets. And you know, our concern with that, right, is that it gives California the impression that we're farther along in meeting our climate goals than we actually are in the real world. And that, you know, these investments, this, you know, hundreds of millions of public dollars look really efficient when each of the individual streams of investment are considered, you know, what caused these reductions. So anyway, this is the much longer conversation, but all that is to say, like, certainly agree with you, Colin, that, you know, CARB needs to take a hard look at how additionality applies to this program.
There definitely needs to be a reevaluation of this whole program, the whole situation, you know, a revamping, not a reevaluation. Been evaluating and talking and pointing and looking for way too long. Action needs to be taken at this time. So we've got a few minutes left, in a minute or less. Anything else that you would like to add, Colin Murphy out there at UC Davis? Go ahead.
Sure. So definitely thank you for having me on. I'm very happy to talk about this, as I'm sure you're gathering. This is an extremely complex topic. There are no simple solutions. I often say one of the ways you can tell if somebody is either, you know, misinformed or lying is if the words "it's simple" ever come out of their mouth. And nothing is. I think if there's one thought I wanted to leave, is that I absolutely understand that the topic of dairy digesters in the LCFS is controversial, and I'm certainly not saying that the current treatment should stay or that it is a success. The program on the whole, though, has been extremely successful at doing what it set out to do. The two jurisdictions that have had it for more than a decade, California and British Columbia, have both more than doubled the amount of transportation fuel coming from non-petroleum sources. They've both seen significant support going to EVs, and it is very hard to envision a pathway to success in California in achieving carbon neutrality by 2045 without the LCFS or something an awful lot like it. So I completely agree that the treatment of dairy digesters needs to change, but I just want to be careful that we don't sort of take the challenges in this one sort of subset of it and use it to tar the whole program. There's a lot of success here as well.
All right, Jamie Katz, go ahead.
Great. Yeah. And again, yeah, thank you so much. This is a great conversation. Really appreciate it. And yeah, encourage folks who want to learn more, want to get involved in the process, reach out to Leadership Council. This is something we've been working on for a long time. We're going to continue working as long as it takes to get this right. You know, I think the bottom line for us is that you know, we have been saying this for a long time. Residents that live near these large dairies have been saying this for a long time. And, you know, what we heard from Professor Michael Wara at the workshop last week sort of underscored this, that California has the ability to meet its climate goals while not continuing to pollute low-income communities of color. California has that ability, and that choosing not to do that is a policy choice. Mm-hmm. And so we would urge California to align its commitment to the climate with its commitment to environmental justice. And it's possible, and now is the moment to make that choice. So thank you so much.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Jamie Katz is a staff attorney with Leadership Council for Justice and Accountability. Their work focuses on co-creating with residents an energy transition that benefits disadvantaged communities in inland California and does not continue patterns of disinvestment, pollution, and environmental racism. And before that, you heard the voice of Colin Murphy. Colin Murphy is the deputy director of the UC Davis Policy Institute for Energy, Environment, and the Economy, and co-director of the UC Davis Institute of Transportation Studies Low Carbon Fuel Policy Research Initiative. Good people. Wow, I feel a heck of a lot smarter. I'm gonna tell you right now, because I don't know. I left that gathering, the Air Resource Board's gathering last week, and I was even more confused. So this conversation has really broken it down, and given me personally a very good understanding of what's going on with these credits, low carbon fuel standards, what it is. You know, it's another new acronym to put in my bonnet. So thank you so much for taking the time, breaking it down. Thank you so much, both of you, for being on A Rude Awakening.
Yeah, very happy to be here. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
And a big thank you to Chloe Ziliak for facilitating that interview you just heard. And folks, just want to let you know that on Saturday, tomorrow, June 10th, Extinction Rebellion SF Bay Area is having an End Fossil Fuel Banner Action. End Fossil Fuel Banner Action. Show solidarity and demand change. This is at 11 a.m. tomorrow, 11 a.m. Bay Area Banner Action. I-80 Pedestrian Bridge. I-80 Pedestrian Bridge in Berkeley. Handmade art encouraged. It starts at 11 a.m. Again, 11 a.m. I-80 Pedestrian Bridge, SF Bay Trail in Berkeley. And that does it for another edition of A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. A big thank you to my guests, Colin Murphy and Jamie Katz, for taking the time. Always, Will Radicule is on the controls. I'll be back next week, same time, same place. Stay tuned for a rebroadcast of Democracy Now! Coming up next. And remember, good people, embrace each other as we embrace the mother of us all.
Howdy, Chris Welch here with a new day for the talkies. Same time, 11 a.m., same station. You're already listening to it, but a new day, Friday. Same mix of politics, culture, and your calls, and it's for 2 hours. Way fun. Hope you'll join me Fridays, 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. for the talkies. See you there.
KPFA has always been more than a radio station.
We're a local destination for discussion and connection.
When you turn on 94.1 FM or check out KPFA's website, you too belong to the Bay Area. Our local programming, news, analysis, culture, and alternative music is reflective of where we live, who we are today,
and how we're growing as a vehicle for community engagement.
Please donate today at kpfa.org. Thank you.
Howard Zinn.
Orwell said that whoever controls the past controls the future. And whoever controls the present controls the past. So whoever is in charge of our society can decide what our history will look like. And by deciding what our history will look like, they will decide our future. Well, that made history very important to me, because it meant that history was not disengaged from society, that to create a more democratic history meant that you were at least playing some part in trying to create a more democratic society.
Storytelling for social change on KPFA.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.